I should go down in history with Sigmund Freud and Jesus.
We're here to alleviate that.
You can't take life so goddamn seriously, honey.
Oh, no, it's the beginning of the end.
Do what you want, do what you want, be what you want.
And it's always the same.
I mean, rock and roll is ridiculous.
I don't know. I guess like my ego could be talking right now and I could say, well, we're interesting people, you know, but I think we're just easy scapegoats.
The way we pronounce the name of the band is Nirvana. It's not Nirvana.
Changed for you guys now being on a bigger label?
We get to be on Much Music.
Yeah.
We could have been on Much Music before if you
really
shown up for the interview.
We're never late now. We're always on time. We're prompt.
We brought watches.
We have tour managers now. We don't get up at 1 o'clock in the morning. Because last time we were here, we were like just us three, you know, driving around. We get up whenever we wanted. Hey, man, that's a pretty long drive to Toronto. We better get going. Like, yeah, shut up. And then we're like, show up as if we're ready to go on.
The first time I heard their tape, I knew they were going to be huge. But you have to remember what huge was then and what huge is now. If I had said at the time that this band is going to sell 10,000 records, even then, you know, in 1988, people would have scoffed. It's like, that's unheard of for a band coming out of nowhere on a small independent record label. And frankly, you know, they ended up selling three times that amount. And relative to our previous position in life, it did make us rich. You know, and, you know, things have progressed from there, and
they made you really rich.
hopefully they've enriched the culture more than they've enriched me.
Why did you entitle the album Nevermind?
I don't know. So I could brush off the question. Forget it. Doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter. No.
There's a certain concept you guys are trying to put across with the cover.
It's open for interpretation. You know, think about a baby swimming through water, dollar bill on a hook. You know, that's a fun part of it. Decipher. Maybe a person could find a new way of life. So we're speaking of paths. They can take off their clothes and bite into a fish hook in water. See how that feels.
Well, I sort of thought it related to the band, though, who's this is sort of your first jump in the water towards the huge bucks and all that.
Right on. Now, see, okay, well, I never thought of that. Well, there you go. That works too. See, it's open for interpretation. This video takes place in a high school gym, and it's like a crazy pep assembly. It's Plum Loco.
Okay, now why'd you use that song for the video, for single and all that?
We just kind of said, hey, what songs? We were asked what songs you guys want to put out first as a single, and we just thought about it. Oh, I say this song. Oh, I say that song. And we thumb wrestled, and we thought Teen Spirit. Let's do Teen Spirit as our first single.
Now, isn't Smell Like Teen Spirit, isn't that from a deodorant commercial or something? Is that where you guys got it from?
No, we didn't get it from that. We found that out later. No,
yeah.
Pure coincidence.
Call it before the Sub Pop sound.
Oh, that the Sub Pop sound.
That's right.
Yeah.
Grunge.
Seattle.
I can't decide.
Seattle Sub Pop grunge.
Where does the term grunge come from?
I have no idea.
I don't know. What is grunge? Don't ask me.
Didn't it mean like just like the mildew on your shower curtain or something like that? And I think the culprit is Mark Arm, the singer from Mudhoney. I think he kind of came up with that term. I'm not sure, but I know he's regretting it.
Yeah, one more time is good enough for me.
Do you mind being described as...
We're the leaders of the grunge movement.
Right. Actually, we've changed it, though, to sponge.
And what's sponge?
Cross between speed metal and grunge. We kind of just soak it all up and squeeze it out.
We're a grunge band. We try to sound like Seattle bands. They're our favorite bands. We want to be like them.
We are Nirvana, actually. We're not Paul, we're Nirvana.
Actually, we were on a plane the other day, and the people said, are you in a band? And he said, yeah. And they said, what band? And we said, we're Nirvana. So they brought out all these papers, and they signed a bunch of papers, Nirvana. Like I said, what did I sign? Chris Novoselic, and this was Kurt Cobain and Dave Grohl.
But that's all we listen to, man. Nirvana, Alice in Chains, L7. That's it. That's the only music, man. Grunge. It's happening. It's now. It's us.
Preaching about world domination, which we did early on in our careers, and saying, you know, this is basically proclaiming Sub Pop and grunge as the sound of the future. We never thought that anything remotely similar to that would ever happen. You know, so it was basically a cosmic checkmate. You know, we didn't really anticipate that happening.
I haven't really come to grips with it yet. We've been in Europe ever since everything's happened.
We haven't been back to America since this whole thing's blown up.
Yeah.
So we really don't know.
And I haven't seen this.
The tour was booked months ago, so we're playing small halls where we would have played before any of this would have happened. So we can't really tell what's changed. But
if anything, it sort of gives me a little faith in, you know, the consumer.
Nevermind was getting really big. It's like we were on tour the whole time and we didn't have time to stop and realize what was going on. And I think that's a blessing in a lot of ways. But just that, when you don't have time to sit down and just think about what's going on and things happen without you realizing.
We have a really bad attitude, and I think a lot of that was born out of like becoming famous right away. You know, like in January of 1990, I was like hiding in my apartment, living in a Nazi police state with the yellow ribbons and flag waving everywhere. You know what I mean? The whole Desert Storm thing. And then in January of 1991, my band's got a number one record. And it's just like I totally like ran away from the mainstream, and now I was like being assimilated into it. And I was really confused and maybe made some statements that were really reactionary, like, you know, or putting our fans down or whatever.
Nirvana.
We love that record. It's great.
If you listen to that record, you can see a real feminine. I mean, that record's selling incredibly, and grunge is taking over, and it's a teen revolution, and we're all very excited about it. But, I mean, the thing is that it's really feminine. You know, it's very compassionate songwriting, and it's not metal posturing.
Yoko Ono of grunge come up when people talk about Courtney and Kurt. How do you feel about that?
Well, see, that's the kind of thing that the press would like people to believe, you know, because Courtney isn't, she's not your typical, like, woman in rock, you know. She's not willing to just sort of sit around and shut up, you know. She's very outspoken, and she's not willing to cooperate with the establishment, you know, and that's one of the things that all of us really respect her for, is because she, you know, she has, she's got a really strong personality that a lot of people just don't understand. And sure, that, you know, if that has something to do with the band, then people immediately just sort of like crucify it as this evil thing within the band. And, you know, people just don't get it.
We're really happy about the Nirvana thing because it's like, it's almost like in the 60s, good music got played on the radio. I mean, that doesn't happen in the 90s. It's like Mariah Carey and Michael Bolton and just shit.
Mm-hmm.
You see the world for what it is. Did you ever have second thoughts about bringing a child into the world the way it is?
Oh, yeah, absolutely, yeah. I really can't describe what changed our attitude so fast. I think, you know, I really was a lot more negative and angry and everything else a few years ago, but that had a lot to do with not having a mate, you know, not having a steady girlfriend and stuff like that. So I, you know, that was one of the main things that was bothering me that I wouldn't admit at the time, you know. So now that I've found that, the world seems a lot better for some reason, you know. It really does change your attitude about things, you know. I mean, 4 years ago I would have said, you know, the classic thing, like, you know, how dare someone bring a child into this life, you know, it's completely a terrible way to go, and, you know, the world's going to explode any day and stuff like that. But once you fall in love, it's a bit different.
I don't want to know about it.
Definitely some insane bohemian culture going on here with all the coffee and goatees and whatever, pretentious whatever. It's not really my scene. So I just kind of ride around on my go-karts and play drums.
Been labeled as punk rock in the first place. We just played in the underground circuit. We like punk rock more than any other style of music, so.
Yeah.
We're punk
rock. Well, I think everybody was sort of into punk rock before the band really evolved anyway.
We were a band.
So it's definitely everyone was sort of bred on the punk thing.
God save the queen! She ain't no human being!
Man, right on. It was just emotionally appealing, you know. It was like acne and you know, a young man finding out about himself and his body. I think music has an effect on young people today, and I think styles are changing. It is, after all, 1993, and
things stagnated there in the late 80s and early 90s with just a lot of cock rock, you know, mainstream middle of the road music. It seemed like there was a blur in the generation gap, and I think things are changing now that youth are finding an identity, and I'm all for it.
Is there anything the same between your music and new wave?
I think so.
Like what?
Well, like, you know, new wave was just a progression from punk rock and a mutation of punk rock, you know, and it was more commercial and more palatable, you know. It had, you know, punk rock roots, and it was easier to swallow for the media and middle America and the middle of the world, and it's just, you know, that's what I kind of think about our music. I'd really like to bring back new wave and break dancing, you know, meld it to something, I don't know. That's what our new music is sounding like. We're using a lot more effects boxes, and we haven't put the skinny ties. Could be talking right now, and I could say, well, we're interesting people, you know, but I think we're just easy scapegoats. It's just, you know, it started with something, and then, you know, people just pick up on it and carry it along, and we turn into cartoon characters, and there's nothing I can do about it, really. You know, I can threaten to sue, and, you know, try to you know, bring up libel laws and stuff like that to people that write shit like that about us, but, you know, if you've ever looked into that, it's pretty much a lost cause. You have to have a lot of money to do that. And, you know, I could spend the money that I earned last year all on fighting the Vanity Fair piece, you know, and they'd end up winning because they have more money. She has me like a posse.
A lot of perspective is heaped upon us, and like our record, and a lot of perspective was heaped upon Nevermind, and like, what kind of record are they going to put out? What are they going to, you know, is it going to be a Screw You album or whatever? And then somebody heard these little whispers in the distance, and they chased them down and really amplified them. And it was just a bunch of ballyhoo, you know, and I think for an establishment news magazine, major establishment news magazine, to print
Newsweek,
to print a full page story on such unsubstantiated nonsense really damages their credibility, you know? Because sure, I mean, there's some dialogue between the label and the management and the band about what the record was about, but I don't think there was like a big scuffle, and I don't think that anybody deemed it commercial suicide. You know, and sure, we remixed a couple songs, but the only reason we remixed them is because us, the band, felt that the songs needed a little more, something extra. And why limit yourself? You know what I mean?
I've just noticed that people expect more of a thematic angle with our music. You know, they always want to read into it. And before, I was just using pieces of poetry and just garbage, you know, just stuff that just would spew out of me at the time. And a lot of times when I write lyrics, it's just at the last second because I'm really lazy. So, and then I find myself having to come up with explanations for it, you know. So I thought I'd, you know, prevent that this time and actually have an explanation for some of the songs at least.
It's kind of stupid because we're just three sort of normal people, relatively normal, I suppose, who just playing a band, and people have sort of turned it into, you know, this, the godfathers of grunge or whatever, and it's just music, it's just a band, it's no big deal to us, I don't suppose, to a lot of other people. It's flattering that people find it something special, but it's, to us, it's just really the same as it's always been.
You know, we always try to convey a sense of humor across, because it is, after all, only entertainment. You know what I mean? And to be ensnarled in the music industry, the music business, to take things so seriously, it's just like, well, jeepers creepers, you know, we have, we're it's a luxury. I mean, we eat every day, we can buy appliances and cars, you know, to take something like that so seriously, it's just, I couldn't imagine it.
So you can just like...
Because we just can't explain ourselves. We don't consciously think about our music, so we can't explain it. Therefore, interviews are worthless. Let's go. What do you think about interviews?
It's a pretty
what
good
do
magazine.
I think?
Really
Did you hear
good.
My reaction when he asked me if I wanted to do one?
Yeah.
I said, fuck no. I said, heck
we were,
no.
We were, an
I mean, we're not like a pop band, you know, but... I don't know.
Papa don't preach.
Pop music.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, how do you feel though about the crossover into the metal market?
That's fine.
Fine.
Yeah.
Well, maybe we could. Few of those kids, they could go from worshiping Satan to being studious and alternative, and some of the alternative people could be like smoking pot on their Camaro hoods. Hoods of their Camaros.
It'll be a
Camaro
trade-off.
Hoods. It'll be a trade-off, yeah. It'll be joint forces. Unite all potheads and bookworms. Come together.
You know, a couple of years ago when we were making these bold negative statements about things like that, you know, we were really confused and we're scared. We're afraid that we would lose a lot of our audience that meant a lot to us because they're people that, you know, we suppose hopefully feel that we have a connection with, you know, the college students and people in the underground. And I don't think we've lost them. I think they're still fans, so I'm not worried about it anymore.
You guys don't like explaining anything to do with your music or to do with what you're doing.
Just like Ricky Ricardo said, splain, Lucy, splain. Lucy never did. Ricky!
Now, okay, now why don't you like talking about it, though? What's the problem with going on camera and just relating a little story to do with it?
There's nothing to be said. It's all in the music, man. It's all in the music. It's all in the meat.
You don't think that people that are fans of you would like to hear what you had in mind, maybe, or what you were...
I don't hear what they have in mind, you know,
yeah.
Or
like
how they interpret
said.
It.
I mean, you
so
would.
Cool. Yeah, I'd like to get some letters. This is what my analytical
my
idea
personal
is, what critical lyrics are. You know, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter, man.
You know what we do is we get all drunk and we get in these heavy philosophical conversations. What we are is we're pothead philosophers with no type of studious background or anything. We just...
You're worried about a Nirvana backlash?
Hasn't that already been over with? Hasn't that already happened? I don't know. Sure. No. I don't know.
Well, I don't plan on doing it for the next 10 years of my life either. So, I mean, you get to a point where, I mean, there's bands that have been around for 20 years, and it's kind of like, it's great that they're still around, and it's great to see people that have that kind of perseverance or whatever, but it's sort of like there's going to come a time where these bands have to move aside, you know, and let something new come through, because you just can't do it forever, you know. And there'll be a time when it's like, you know, people will be slagging off Nirvana as the...
Oh, they're doing it already.
Oh, well, no, but I mean, as the dinosaurs, you know. I mean, now we're like, people hate us now because we're the new little brats on the scene, you know, and we love to piss people off. And so, but there will come a time where it'll be like, you know, oh, we're going to go all the way back to 1993 to a golden oldie, you know, smells like Teen Spirit. still the three of us, so it's still the same kind of Nirvana songwriting, but it's a lot more spontaneous, and it has a lot, the energy is real, and there's no studio trickery, and there's really no outboard effects or anything to make it other than the sounds of the instruments. And so, I mean, the way Steve Albini records, he just sort of throws up mics and records. So,
what do you need a producer for then?
Well, because he knows how to get room sounds, like his drum sound is sort of infamous, and so that was one of the main factors in getting him. And plus, he just he's not willing to cooperate with any sort of like big business, you know, back padding or whatever. He just sort of records a band, and he refused to talk to our management, and he refused to talk to our label when we recorded. He said, "You guys want me to record you? You pay me, I'll record you, I hand you the tapes, and then that's it." And so that's basically what it was.
It's a real mixed bag of songs, like, you know, some really fast rockers, couple stompers, and there's a couple of really mellow, nice songs, cello embellishment on there, you know.
So, happy with it?
Yeah, I'm really happy, I'm really proud of that record. I think it's the best record we could have made.
A lot of stations in the States got a hold of our new album, but it was like someone had anonymously sent them like fifth generation cassette copies of our new album, and in order for them to play it, they started on the weekend at 5 o'clock, like on Friday nights. That way they could play it throughout the rest of the weekend without having a council, you know, sue them. And that's kind of smart, you know.
Ultimately, the album's going to come out.
That's true, but the thing is that there's been so much controversy about how bad the record sounds, you know, and how lo-fi it is. And to hear it like that compared to all the other songs that were on the radio that night, it really disgusted me, and it pissed me off because it sounded terrible. It sounded really, really bad. And then everyone that heard it that weekend is going to say, yeah, you're right. Okay, the stories are true. Then the Ron album really sucks, and I'm not going to buy it, you know, so... It just kind of bothered me, but we took care of it.
What'd you do?
Well, I thought maybe we should hire a lawyer to stop them to do it, then instead I just decided to hire Hitman.
Pardon me?
Nothing. Erase that.
Nirvana's done pretty well in the past few years, and I wonder if it's true that money can't buy happiness.
Well... Yeah, you can't buy happiness. I mean, that made me happy for a little while. But, I mean, I was just probably almost as happy with, you know, I don't know, I look back on going to secondhand stores and stuff like that and finding a little treasure like that. And that actually meant more to me because it was more of a stab in the dark in a way, you know, because you didn't know if you're going to be able to afford it and you don't know what you're really looking for, and when you find it, it's more special to you. Rather than, you know, having $1,000 and going into a store like that and just buying the whole store, you know, it's not as, you know, it's not as special.
It just depends, you know, what makes you happy. Money can buy you comfort, but emotional comfort, I mean, I'm just lucky that I have friends and family that I love and respect, and I'm really happy to be in the band and to work with Kurt and Dave That's like a real philosophical, I mean, arguing point, you know. I mean, if you want to go out and buy some Porsche or something, you're happy with it, that's fine. But some people aren't happy. I'm happy with a 1971 Volkswagen Fastback, you know what I mean? That's what I bought. And it takes a lot of pressure off us. You know, we used to live in these just tiny apartments, pay like $200 a month rent, and then just squeeze by every month. And I'm lucky that my wife worked. She made sandwiches at Boeing, and you know, and I'd bring home, I think my part of the deal was to pay the $200 rent, like to say that I'm paying rent here. That was my role, you know. But I mean, she carried me.
Grape, by grape, by grape. every single grape on the plate. Then I go to the oranges. There are 5 oranges. No, there are 6. They're being hidden by the grapes. Then I'll eat every grape. Then there is the kiwis. There is only 4 kiwis because they're so precious. It's a fruit you don't find everywhere. Then I go to the brie. The brie, there is 3 slices, half of which I've eaten 1. And then I go to the bread. And the bread, this is the soft bread. This is the Melba toast. And this is the wheat bread. And then I shall drink every spa canister on this table. Not only that, but the Royal Club Light. But I don't like Pepsi. I drink Coke. And there's ice. Ice. Ice for everyone. You don't find ice in Holland.
I love my ice.
And then I'll drink the beer. But no, I'll share the beer. And I'll share the wine. Would you like to have a glass of wine?
I would love to have your wine.
All the potato chips. I will eat the chips. There are 3 flavors. I'll eat them all. And a box of juice. Would you like some?
Your juice is doing something for me.
I will shake the juice till it bursts. Oh, yes. I love your juice. I love your juice.
Think your marriage is going to ground you?
I hope so. Maybe, eventually. I mean, it's not going to stop me from playing music, I know that, but, yeah, it might be.
You're getting old and see it. Look at this.
Well, now I'm looking at the beautiful gray skies and thinking, oh, my wife's at home, my fiance is at home. Hey, wait, I think the fact that we never intended to anything like this, you know, we didn't expect anything, and I think that if you got your heart set on being a rock star and you become a rock star, you're a great rock star. You know, you live in a mansion and you marry a model and you're an asshole, you know. And a lot of cases that's true. If you don't really want to, you know, be in some huge band and things get really crazy, I mean, things get crazy, but it's not really that big of a deal. All it is that there's a lot of attention put on you, and I think in a lot of people's cases, it just sort of blows up your head, and it makes you feel, you know, like you're really great. And you don't take it as flattering, you just sort of expect that. And so I think the three of us still think it's pretty strange that people find us, you know, special. And I think it's flattering. I think it's really great. I don't fully understand it, but we're still, you know, the same three people that we were then.
This sounds like the closing of the chapter of the formula we've been using, you know? It's like grunge is, it's really kind of boring for us, you know? It's something we can't deny, and we're not going to stop playing the old songs live. Whoops. And but you know, our tastes are just changing so rapidly that we're really experimenting with a lot of stuff, and it might get too indulgent and be really embarrassing for the next album, but we can't put out another album, and this is just like the last chapter of three chord grunge music for us.
I can sit here and say that I'll do this for a few more years and then have a normal life. But I know that in 10 years, sure, I'll miss it, you know. There's a lot of things about this that I'll miss. There's a lot of things about it that I'll be glad I don't have to deal with anymore.
What are you going to miss?
I'll miss being on stage with Chris and Kurt, you know, and some of the insane shit that happens when we play, stuff like that, you know. The good little moments here and there.
Chris and Dave and I haven't changed at all. I mean, believe it or not, we get along just as well as we ever did. You know, we're just as the same passive aggressive people as we used to be. You know, we never fight, and when we're pissed off at each other, we just hold it under our breath and have respect for one another in that way. You know, it's just, it's easier to work that way, you know, because we have a mission, I guess.
What else should I be? All apologies. What else should I say?
some assignments are tougher than others. This is one of the toughest. This is attending the Kurt Cobain Memorial at the Seattle Center. Some 10,000 people in this area. It used to be the site of the World's Fair, right underneath the Space Needle. I've come here out of grief and frustration, some of them out of anger. Anger at being abandoned by one of their heroes. But everybody came for one reason, to pay their respects to Kurt Cobain. And yes, there were eulogies. Yes, there were people from all walks of life. Whole families were here. But it wasn't until a tape was played from Courtney Love that literally the place and time stood still.
I don't really think it takes away his dignity to read this, considering that it's addressed to most of you. He's such an asshole. I want you all to say asshole really loud. I haven't felt the excitement of listening to as well as creating music, along with really writing something for too many years now. I feel guilty beyond words about these things. On our last three tours, I got a much better appreciation of all the people I've known personally and as fans of our music, but I still can't get out the frustration, the guilt, or the empathy I have for everybody. There's good in all of us, and I simply love people too much. So why didn't you just fucking stay? So much that it makes me feel too fucking sad. Thank you all from the pit of my burning, nauseous stomach for your letters and concern during the last years. I'm too much of an erratic, moody person that I don't have the passion anymore. And so remember, and don't remember this, because this is a fucking lie. It's better to burn out than to fade away. God, you asshole. Peace, love, empathy, Kurt Cobain.
What else should I be? I'll apologize.
Everybody getting together here is a very important thing, to let a lot of stuff go and to show each other that there are other people feeling the same way that you feel.
My friend and I, like, were talking the other day, and we were, like, thinking, like, comparing Kurt Cobain to Jim Morrison, just because, like, he kind of got the Seattle...
Into the light.
Yeah, yeah, into, like, the grunge. He's, like, the one that kind of got Seattle on the map. Yeah, and it's, like, he was this great performer, and he was really good in concerts, and he had this great music, and now all of a sudden he's gone.
You just got to move on, you know? It's a tragedy, and it is a tragedy, but you got to move on. You got to think about what he did do, and not what he... You got to think of his musical talents, what he did. And just don't think about that tragic morning whenever he chose to take his own life.
Kurt Cobain has killed himself, and we are left as survivors to make sense of this death. There is anger, there are feelings of sadness. We don't understand why. And the difficult part about suicides are that the answers are taken away with Kurt. He knew the whys. We don't all know all the reasons.
On behalf of Dave, Pat, and I would like to thank you all for your concern at this time. We remember Kurt for what he was, caring, generous, and sweet. Let's keep the music with us. We'll always have it, forever. Kurt had an ethic toward his fans that was rooted in the punk rock way of thinking. No band is special, no player royalty. That's a level that Kurt spoke to us on, in our hearts. And that's where he and the music will always be, forever.
I was really angry at Kurt Cobain for what he did, so I came to mourn the loss of Nirvana, more or less. I'm still angry.
Sounded like Courtney was angry
too. That really affected me a lot. That really influenced how I feel about this. And I'm glad I came down here and heard it.
Yeah, I'm really kind of worried about Courtney now at this point, you know. I mean, she's had a rough time with the media before, and I could just see that a lot of people would make a field day out of this. So I hope she looks out for herself.
Who do you think's come here today?
I think people that are just looking for some place to be where they can share their thoughts with friends and other people that understand. I guess it's sort of a way for the community to say goodbye. 92, you heard Teen Spirit being played everywhere. But when I finally got the record and listened to it myself, and just, you know, heard the great surge of anger and emotion, and I thought, oh, no wonder this clicked with teenagers. It's loud, it's angry, it's noisy, it's screams of frustration. It's the perfect teenage anthem.
I'm here to talk about the death of Kurt Cobain because I think his death was a great loss to the music industry. I think we lost a great songwriter. He will be missed by our generation.
I think if there was a John Lennon type figure for the so-called Generation X listener, the kids, young people in their teens and 20s of today, it would be Cobain.
If it wasn't for Kurt, there would probably be no Pearl Jam, Stone Temple Pilots, Soundgarden, or any of that movement, which is, you know, hitting the charts at number one. Guess that you don't care about it
now. The whole alt underground scene's like coming to light because of like Nirvana success, and like everything's just, it, you know, regular radio stations will play bands like us now. Right. It's like, I mean, 2 years ago, nobody would have, I mean, it wouldn't even have been considered. They would have heard that and they would have just laughed and said, are you kidding? Hey, wait, I gotta look away
forever to your prize. I think it's great, you know, to see bands like Nirvana coming out and blowing everybody's perceptions away of what the music business should be. You know, everybody's like going around wringing their hands, going, everything, it's all screwed up. It's not the way it used to be, and it's how it should be.
Either I've accepted it or I've gone beyond insane to where I can deal with it emotionally. I really don't care. I know that I'm too stubborn to allow myself to ever compromise their music or, you know, get so wrapped up in it and involved to where it's going to, you know, turn us into big rock stars. I mean, I just don't feel like that. Everyone else accuses us of it, but, you know, we're not as popular as everyone thinks, or we're not as rich as everyone thinks, you know? It's just, we've always had a good sense of humor. I don't think that's been translated very well, you know, but we'd rather laugh about it. Ha ha